Hello, I welcome you to my talk on Derrida's deconstruction. I will discuss one of the most important controversies surrounding deconstruction. And the controversy is whether deconstruction is political or apolitical. I will discuss the pros and cons of both aspects. And then after discussing all that, I will try to show that Derrida's deconstruction is a thoroughly political tool, strategy, methodology, approach, philosophy, or theory. Derrida is generally regarded as the most controversial of all the philosophers of the 20th century. There is no doubt that Derrida has destabilized the foundations of traditional epistemology and ontology with his focus on decentering difference and his rejection of logocentrism, phonocentrism, and phallocentrism. He has been called as infant terrible. Terrible in the sense that his theories, they terrify the traditional thinkers and philosophers who are not ready to give up their traditional opinions and views about life, nature, philosophy, and everything. Derrida's deconstruction has been variously celebrated and castigated as everything from a kind of intellectual terrorism that seeks to destroy everything Western culture holds dear to a liberatory politics or personal choice. So there are two opposite arguments. One says that this is an intellectual terrorism that terrorizes the traditional foundations of Western culture, civilization, and epistemology. And then there are who say that it is leads to liberatory politics and it is just a matter of choice. I will come to these things later on. Paul says that Derrida, with a major philosophical coup, has cast the entire history of philosophy in the West into doubt. And this is truth in the sense that Derrida interrogates the Western philosophies, starting right from Plato to his day, and he critiques all the major Western philosophers and bases his deconstruction and other views on the basis of his critical analysis of the traditional Western philosophy, and he just reverses the main arguments of the traditional Western philosophy and epistemology. And he has cast the entire history of philosophy in the West into doubt. Deconstruction as being politically influential, inert, with no agenda. Now look at this argument. This is totally opposite to the earlier one. Earlier here, we find that Derrida's deconstruction is considered a political coup. But the other side of the opinion is that it is politically ineffectual, inert, with no agenda, that it has done nothing. It is just a simple tool or strategy, and it does nothing. And another allegation on Derrida is that he has oversimplified the Western philosophy by suggesting that it thrives only on binaries and centers, that Derrida talks only of binaries and centers, and there is much more to Western philosophy than these two concepts or stereotypes. Deconstruction is termed as parasitic, as it emerges only out of the study of some texts and does not have any independent existence as such. Now, according to this opinion, there is no deconstruction before the text. There is no already determined formula, strategy, or tool that exists independently. Deconstruction comes into action only when it confronts a text. and each text is deconstructed according to the center on which it is based, according to the ideology that it embodies, and according to the textual practices that encode that text. In this way, deconstruction thoroughly depends on the text that on which it is applied. So there is no deconstruction prior to the text, you may say this. In this way, if we say, then deconstruction is can be called as parasitic, because it depends on the text. But then what it does to the text, that is not parasitic. Okay, it devours the text and it gives a new meaning and new dimension to the text, a dimension that text itself probably was not or is not aware of. It decenters all the binding forces, all the cohesive elements in a text that probably even the writers were not aware of. So in this way, deconstruction may be termed as parasitic on technical grounds, but as a tool, it is not parasitic. It just kills the text that it studies. Some contend that deconstruction, by just focusing on the text, ignores the social, political, and historical context of the production of the text. Now, again, this approach is based on misconception. The misconception here is that perhaps deconstruction is similar to formalism, in the sense that as formalism focuses only on the text, only on the words on the page, and ignores the context, deconstruction also ignores the context. But the difference here is that deconstruction implies that the context resides inside the text, and one does not have to look outside the text to find the context. For example, if we want to study the role of race, gender, and the politics in Shakespeare's age, we don't have to go for the history books. We can just study Shakespeare's works, and from his works, we can find out all the tensions, all the social, cultural, political, and gender-based tensions in his text, and we don't need to go for the text. Rather, we can develop the context of the text from the text. This is very important. This is one of the most crucial statements of Derrida, that there is nothing outside the text. And this, as I discussed earlier, this is not a formalistic position. Derrida contends that text within itself carries the seeds of production of the text, and one does not have to look outside for the clues. Why? Because earlier it was believed that text is based on center, that approach is logocentric. As Derrida contends that text is a construct that is constructed through language. Language works on the principle of difference. So difference replaces logocentrism, and wherever there is difference, meaning is always deferred, and meaning is always differential. It can never be same, and there can never be a closure that a text can experience. So in this way, Derrida's saying there is nothing outside the text is a very politically charged. Derrida too never tried the same strategy twice. Rather, Derrida even hated the word deconstruction, and it was not possible for Derrida to repeat the same strategy twice. Why? Because as each text demands a different strategy, so same strategy cannot be applied to two texts, as two texts are always bound to be different. He studied and critiqued every text according to its own intrinsic merit and assumptions, and in a peculiar way. Why? Because every text is, of course, peculiar. As every text is peculiar, different, therefore it needs a different approach, a different methodology, a different formula, and a different focus. This implies that that there can be as many deconstructive strategies as there are texts. So this baffles the critics and they find it hard to digest. Why do they find it hard to digest? Is Derrida's deconstruction nihilistic? Deconstruction is also termed as nihilistic. It is said that it destroys everything without putting forward any solution or suggesting anything positive. Deconstruction is said to have created an epistemological chaos by smashing the foundations of the Western tradition. So in this context, this statement shows that some critics think that deconstruction negates only, it does not affirm anything. It does not posit any belief, any system, any ideas. It rather destabilizes everything, even its own assumptions. Derrida's freeing the signifier from the signified has led to undermining the stability and sanctity of the meaning. When Saussure said that there is an arbitrary link between signifier and signified, but this link is a social fact, his saying led to structuralism, that there is, of course, a link between signifier and signified. Derrida delinked signifier from the signified, and he said that one signifier leads to another signifier, and there is no signified. In this way, he liberated meaning from all the bases, from all the ideologies to which it was attached, and like a free-floating signifier, meaning also became free-floating. He is believed to have produced a crisis of meaning by disconnecting the signifier from the signified. According to Berlin, deconstruction is a conceptual analysis of the master concepts of Western philosophy like presence, identity, voice, and consciousness. And this is important, that Derrida has actually decentered master concepts of West. Three concepts that are very important, they are logocentrism, phonocentrism, and phallocentrism. And these concepts, they have been challenged and rejected by Derrida. And he says that at the base of Western philosophy are these four major terms: presence, identity, voice, and conscious. Deconstruction now means simply analysis with a political force. So deconstruction is a political analysis. It seeks to recover the suppressed concepts and others from the layers of history and knowledge. So when Derrida challenges boundaries and terms the boundaries as cultural and not natural, and this breaking of boundaries creates or recovers the other who has been suppressed in the layers of history and knowledge, this is one of the major contributions of Derrida, that his deconstruction has created other. Deconstruction has the capacity to expose ideological lies, to dismantle cultural cover-ups. Deconstruction especially challenges and destabilizes the Western metaphysics of presence, the Western master concepts. As Jung says, Robert Jung says, it is this sovereign self of Europe which is today being deconstructed, showing the extent to which Europe's other has been a narcissistic self-image through which it has constituted itself, that Europe derives its identity from the other, while never allowing it to achieve a perfect fit. This can be applied to Derrida's critique of a certain fundamental Europeanization of world culture. So in this way, according to Young, Derrida has challenged the fundamental Europeanization of the world. The spread of European culture and values and systems of economy and politics to the rest of the world. These are what are at stake when we go for deconstruction. For we can say that deconstruction involves decentralization and decolonization of European thought. This is again by Robert Young. So what we get out of Young's critique of deconstruction is that the Western tradition, whether it be philosophical or literary, far from being universal, natural, neutral, and objective, is just ethnocentric or simply ethnic. Now, this is a mighty fall that Western civilization, which was propagated and perpetuated on all the world, all the rest of the world, as universal, objective, neutral, natural, in the end turns out to be just ethnocentric or simply ethnic. So this is what deconstruction has done. So if deconstruction can bring down such huge, large portmanteau concepts of Western philosophy, then it cannot be apolitical. It is political. What does deconstruction hold for the other subaltern, oppressed, margin, and periphery? What does it hold? It recovers all of these. Deconstruction promises recovery, revival, regeneration, and rediscovery of the other and subaltern, and those lying at the margin of either history or geography. This is Derrida's deconstruction's contribution to humanity. Deconstruction has impacted every field of knowledge. Post-structuralism, postmodernism, post-colonial theory, feminism, critical race theory, and all other theories in social sciences are the direct offshoots of Derrida's deconstruction. There is nothing outside deconstruction. We are actually living in the age of Derrida. Derrida's deconstruction is political. Derrida has radically revolutionized and reshaped human knowledge and life. His impact can be seen in policies and regulations. Derrida has critically impacted the concepts of race, gender, class, and decentered truth, center, objectivity, universality, presence, and logos. There is nothing outside deconstruction. Hey, what are you watching? You don't know why are you watching this video. Derrida knows. So the conclusion is that whatever we say, whatever we do, and whatever we think has been irreversibly impacted by Derrida's deconstruction. And deconstruction is 100% political tool, strategy, theory, and philosophy. Okay, thank you very much. Good luck.